again, everybody, and welcome to another edition of Prep Huddle Live on StriveSports.com. My name is Eric Algin. We've got a great show for you today. Here it is, the final Wednesday of the month, almost. It's crazy how fast everything has gone, but very soon we'll be talking about district wrestling and then sub-district and district basketball for the girls and then the boys, and then the state tournaments will be upon us. The winter sports season will be a lot of fun. All of our guests today joining us on the Truck Center Company's hotline, and of course, for great career opportunities or maybe an opportunity you didn't know was out there, you can log on to their website at dieseltex.com. Our rundown today, it's a good one, folks. We've got Aurora boys coach Tom Leininger talking about his Huskies. We had him got this recorded earlier this morning, so we'll get to that in just a little bit. We're going to go way up north, probably buried in some snow right now, is the Valentine Wrestling coach Shane Allison. His Badgers will be digging out, I'm sure, quite soon. And then we go to Grand Island for Northwest coach Rico Burkett as he talks about his girls on the Northwest side, losing last night in the Central 10 Conference, but still a nice season so far and looking forward to more things. We've got highlights galore. We've got four different packages we could show you this week, and Tony Chapman with a conference basketball tournament update. And don't forget, at the very end of our show, if you've been paying attention the last few weeks, we have had the Strive TV GoPro giveaway. We've opened up a contest for our Strive schools to submit and post on their social medias school spirit videos. And so we were calculating up the likes and the views and the tweets and all different stuff to come up with the grand total number, if you will, of everything that can be seen. And so we have our winner picked. We found it. And we will announce that at the end of the show. So one of our Strive schools is going to get a brand new, still in the box. It's right up there on the shelf right now. Still in the box, GoPro session, courtesy of Strive TV. So we're excited to announce that coming up a little bit later on this afternoon. Now we've got our interview with Coach Tom Leininger. That's next. Tom Leininger has his Aurora Huskies ranked number one in Class B. They're 15-0 after a win last night. He joins us on the Truck Center Company's hotline. Coach, thanks a lot for coming on today.
No problem. Thanks for having me.
Let's talk a little bit about your game last night, a win over Grand Island Northwest, 64-37. Always a good way to start the Central Conference tournament, and that's with a W.
Yeah, it is. You know, it's a little sloppy at times. They're very aggressive and come out and kind of disrupt what you want to try to do. I think we fought through it fairly well for the most part. We had kind of even scoring, 19 in the first quarter, 19 in the second quarter, and it kind of built a little bit of a lead and played all right from there, I guess.
Let's go back to the last tournament that you guys played, which was the Gretna Holiday Tournament back there over the Christmas break. You guys beat Pius by 14, and then you beat Gretna by 4 on their home floor. How big were those two games in particular for the guys' confidence and just being able to say, yeah, we can play at and above the top teams in this class?
Yeah, I think it was really big for us. Last year we go 25-2 and played at a very high level, and so the bar was set pretty high with these kids. They demand that of themselves, and they expect that, I guess. And you never know where you have the bar set and where it actually is sometimes a little bit different. But yeah, they were able to come out and play pretty well. The Pius still hasn't been beat besides us, and I see they rolled again last night. A very good Class A team, and Gretna, of course, very, very good basketball team, and going to be one of the best teams come March too.
How has it been for this group of guys to have the bar, as you said, it was set so high from last year, and a nice group that came back from last year's team, almost all of your main scoring production, actually. So has there been anything that has kind of surprised you so far that these guys have done?
Well, no, I don't think so. We've got a sophomore that stepped up into our starting lineup. But I don't know how much of a surprise that was, because he just had a phenomenal off season for us in Shireman. So any good surprise, I guess any surprises I've got so far are good surprises. I think the kids have accepted their roles very well so far. And And that's a huge thing. And, whether they're playing 25 minutes a game or whether they're playing 4 minutes a game, I think they're playing really hard. And like I said, accepting their role and doing what they do best.
Austin Allen gets a lot of headlines for you guys, and deservedly so. He'll, in a couple of Tuesdays, he'll be signing with Nebraska, of course, for football. But your son Tommy is going off to Briar Cliff, and we had a chance to do a feature with those guys a couple weeks ago, actually in the first part of January. So I got to ask, since I asked Tommy what it was like playing for Dad, what's it like coaching Tommy?
Oh, yeah. well, it's good. I wish I could coach a Tommy every year. He's my third son that I've coached, and I think we have a pretty good relationship on the court and off the court with all three of them. And Tommy has been no different. He's a very coachable kid, and he's a team player. He's a coach's dream, actually, whether he's my son or your son. I mean, once we get out there, I don't think it really makes that much difference.
So besides those guys who are going to play at the next level, Tommy's going to go off to Briar Cliff, Austin, of course, to Nebraska. You've got a lot of guys that have made some contributions. You mentioned Shireman. Henry Penner is a guy that, for some reason, he just keeps popping up in our highlight package that we put together every week. And you've got a lot of guys that are making some contributions. So let's shine the light on them a little bit.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, we're where we're at because of our team, not because of one or two players. And when you take a look at us, I just don't think there's one guy that you can say we need to stop this guy, or two or three. I mean, we put five guys on the floor that can score. Cade Morrell has run the point for us for 2 years, and you just can't leave him open. He penetrates well, just a real heady player. We already talked a little bit about Baylor. He's really coming on, and he had 18 last night. Shoots very well from very deep. I mean, it just really stretches defenses. Like you said, Henry Penner is just—he's kind of a highlight reel waiting to happen. I mean, he's very, very athletic. I mean, he plays a guard for us, a 6'5" guard that can absolutely leap out of the gym. He can guard their big guy, or he can go out and guard their guard. I mean, he's just kind of a special player. Jordan Stevenson, Zach Stevenson, his brother. Started all last year for us, and now it's kind of taken a backup role. But when he comes in the game, just plays really well for us. Hunter Holiday, another senior, same thing. Comes in and just does his role. Came in last night and got a big rebound and stuck it back in, and then made the free throw. Trent Wilson comes off the bench for us, and he actually started against Central City. And in the start he had a double-double at halftime. He's just a kid that attacks the glass really well, offensive boards, and does some really good things for us. So, I mean, when you take a look at us, we play eight kids every game, and they all contribute. I mean, we don't have anybody that hurts us when we put them in the game. We're actually starting to play a little Cade Reichardt, a sophomore, a little bit more too, who really does some good things from the perimeter for us. So, we definitely have some depth.
You mentioned Trent Wilson, and that sparked a thought I had when I was interviewing with Austin and Tommy. I asked them what it was like when Austin went out this summer with his knee injury, because I know you guys did still basically everything that you were planning to do, whether Austin was with you or not. And it kind of allowed a guy, and they mentioned Trent specifically, but how was it to kind of watch a team kind of grow over the summer when you take away a 6'9" post?
Oh, yeah, it was fun. I mean, the schedule we lined up was unbelievable. I mean, I think we played 14 college teams, and we played 11 Class A teams, and we got beat bad twice. Once was the very first college team we played. We weren't ready for that, and then we played them well in that league from there on out. And then we got beat bad by one Class A team where I kind of got a little discouraged with our starters, and I just played the second team the whole second half, and they kind of rolled us. But besides that, when you take a look at the top teams in Class A, we played and beat some of those without Oz. So, we had a really good summer.
So I want to ask, because last week we had Drake Baranek, who's a coach at Kearney in his second year, and he's a relative newcomer to the coaching scene. We asked him about his influences, and he specifically mentioned coaches that he had played for and drawn inspiration from. You are a little bit more experienced, shall we say, in the coaching profession, so I'm curious who you would draw inspiration from.
Well, in the first place, I started at Columbus Scotus, and I had some phenomenal guys to work under and with in multiple sports. You know, the Pitts brothers and Coach Lahm and Coach Fincieri and Coach Peterson, and those guys are they were phenomenal coaches and phenomenal people. I drew a lot of X's and O's and a lot of inspiration and perspiration with those guys. So. That kind of got the ball rolling. I've kind of I've stole a lot from a lot of people at a lot of different levels, whether that's, a lot of the college coaches to some of the college girls coaches. I mean, to high school coaches, in 31 years, you steal from about everybody you can, I guess.
And then one last question before we let you go. What is the biggest key for this group going forward? Austin and Tommy in the first part of the month had mentioned that there's some lofty goals. So what are going to be the biggest keys for you guys going forward from this?
Well, I think our key is just to keep it going. I mean, I think that we are, when we played the Pius and Gretna, that tournament, if you're satisfied, I think you kind of plateau. I think we're playing a lot better than what we did then. I mean, I think this team understands that that doesn't mean anything. Quite frankly, the conference tournament is one of our biggest tournaments. So hopefully we're going up and up as we go every game, every practice. And I think they're doing that. I think we're improving weekly, maybe even daily.
Well, it should be fun to watch the rest of the way. Can't wait for that. And Coach Tom Leininger with Aurora, thanks a lot for taking time with us today.
No problem. It was fun.
We'll be back with more Prep Huddle Live coming up next on strivesports.com. Next up on Prep Huddle Live here on StriveSports.com, we've got Shane Allison. He's the head coach at Valentine for the wrestling program. Coach, thanks a lot for digging out of the snow to join us today.
Oh, we appreciate that, Barry. We appreciate the coverage.
Let's talk a little bit about actually the end of last season. You guys were runners-up to David City in both the team championships and the dual championships in Kearney. How did those close finishes impact your offseason work for the guys?
Well, I think the guys come in pretty focused this year. We knew we had a good team returning, and we made some off-season tournaments. We went to had a lot of kids at camp this summer. And I give them a break before football starts, and just kind of let them rejuvenate and come in fully charged. So they come in focused and ready to go this year.
Let's talk about some of the guys that make up this year's squad. I know you've kind of been following along with any wrestle, and you guys have had some guys miss some time, but who are the ones that have been stepping up this year?
Well, Jordan Kelberry is a state champ 2 years ago and third a year ago. The kid's just really come into his own. He's undefeated on the year. He's very focused. He didn't like how his state tournament ended last year with the third place finish rather than a championship. So, he's one of our leaders on our team. We got a little freshman at 113 pound who's undefeated right now, Gage Kulikowski, and he's looking strong and he's wrestled the top dogs in his weight class and dominated so far. So we're looking for good things out of him. We go up and down our lineup, and our lineup is full of leaders like Noah Eklund and Hudson Pierman, who were both runners up 2 years ago, and DJ Steven, who's an outstanding junior. He's really coming on late in the year. So, it's hard to pinpoint one or two guys because we got a bunch of them stepping up.
Wrestling is such a physically demanding sport. What do you stress to the kids outside of practice to kind of have them be able to take the best care of themselves?
Well, we really stress nutrition and eating right and getting plenty of sleep. You know, that's very important down the stretch. Sickness is going to hit. It hit us hard last week. I think we only had 7 varsity guys in the tournament last week. So it's going to hit, but they recover faster when they're in great shape and when they're taking care of themselves. So we really push nutrition. We try and get them, we encourage them to get on a multivitamin and make sure they're getting plenty of sleep and keeping up with their studies.
Eat, sleep, and study, and there's a little wrestling in there too. Talk about the competition you guys faced throughout the year. I know there's been some good ones. You guys have gone to some big meets, and maybe a little bit of how that prepares you, hopefully, for what comes in February.
Well, you know, we want to put our kids in situations where they've been in tough matches all year long. You know, that kind of lost out on that when we were missing our home meet. It got canceled. That's a really good one. We went to the High Plains tournament instead to try and get more matches in. We saw some great competition down there. The Schuyler meet's a good tournament there. And then last weekend we went to the Shadron meet, which has, you know, 25, 30 teams and some large class schools as well. So we want those kids to have their toughest matches of the year before they get to the state tournament. That way, when they get down into a, you know, blood and guts round and they have to dig deep to pull out a win, they've been there before and they know how to react.
And also, it's not necessarily the longest season as far as the winter sports are concerned, but it's such a grind anyway. How do you try to keep the guys fresh in practices in January so that they're ready for those meets?
Yeah, January really is a grind with us. We really got some tough tournaments in January. Our schedule's set up so that at the end of the year, we go to Ainsworth this coming week, which is our closest tournament, only 45 miles away. And then our conference meet's held on a Friday, which gives them a weekend off over right before the district meet. So our schedule's set up really nice to where the kids do get a little bit of a chance to recharge and get focused before that district meet.
And you mentioned that Ainsworth being the close drive at 45 minutes, that's something that you see a lot more, obviously, the farther west you go in the state. How big of an impact is driving, especially when you've got to be at an event so early in the morning to try to get the kids up and have them ready to go right away in a big day?
Well, you know, we got to travel out here. We're just kind of in the middle of nowhere. So we do a lot of traveling. We went down to and dueled Columbus and Lincoln, and then had the Schuyler meet. That was a early morning to get up, and they got early weigh-ins there. And then the next week we're at Shadron, and I do think the kids miss out on some sleep there. And I think that, you know, the sickness that hit us this last week had something to do with the maybe a little bit of lack of sleep. But it's just one of those things. If you're going to seek out good competition, you need to travel and you need to go search out those good teams and wrestle that good competition. So it's kind of a, you know, double-edged sword there. You spend time traveling, you lose out maybe a little sleep, but you do get to see the good competition as well. So we just try and balance that the best we can. And again, staying close to home towards the end of the year really helps.
Coach, before we let you go, one last time, I want to kind of ask you, what is the message for the guys as they get ready for here the end of January and just a few weeks left of the season? What's the biggest message to try to bring home some of those state medals?
You know, we just trying to stay relaxed and stay focused on our job. We haven't talked state championship at all this year. That's not something that we're talking about. We're just talking about improving every single time we go out there on the mat. And we're trying to take the pressure off the kids this year. The last 2 years we've been runners up, and I think the kids have felt some pressure down the stretch. And this year we just refocused on improvement every time we step on the mat. So I think that has taken some of the pressure off, and we'll see if it pays off.
It will be fun to follow along the rest of the way. Coach Shane Allison with Valentine, thanks so much for the time. Best of luck to you and the guys the rest of the way.
All right, thank you.
When we come back here on Prep Huddle Live on StriveSports.com, we're going to talk girls basketball with Northwest coach Rico Burkett. That's next.
Yeah, I get it. For the little things, technology's great. It makes things easier. It's faster. We can get things done wherever we go. And we get all that from our bank. It works for us. But for the bigger things, the things that really count, I still want to talk to the people I know and trust. That's why I'm here.
Hey, what's going on?
Just checking the fields. Yours are looking pretty good. Unless you're doing something right.
Actually, I got a guy.
You got a guy.
Well, it's not just any guy. I got a channel seedsman.
Channel, yeah?
Yeah, I've been working with him pretty close to get. Well, you can see for yourself.
This is what I'd recommend.
Let's get to work.
Now, this is what you want to see.
Maybe I should get a guy.
Maybe you should get a channel seedsman.
Find your channel seedsman at channel.com.
Nova Fitness Equipment of Omaha has provided the very best weight room, track and field, and sports surfacing products for over 30 years in Nebraska. They provide Cybex, Matrix Fitness, Vertimax, Tough Stuff, Pro Elite, Stairmaster, York Barbell, Troy Barbell, and UCS Track and Performance products. From rubber flooring, strength equipment, cardio products, and sports performance accessories, Nova Fitness Equipment has what you need to make your athletic program successful. Contact Nova Fitness Equipment today at their home office in Omaha or online at Nova Fitness Equipment.
Home-cooked favorites and online ordering so you can skip the line. That's what you'll find at Dickey's Barbecue in York. Log on to dickeys.com, select the York address, sign in or create a profile, and you'll be ordering delicious barbecue in just seconds. Choose from a variety of meats like brisket, pulled pork, chicken breast, or sausage. Add a home-style side like waffle iron fries, fried onion tanglers, barbecue beans, and even fried okra. You won't go away hungry. Try Dickey's Barbecue today and log on to dickeys.com. Kids eat free on Sundays.
The trucking industry gives you a lot of opportunity for careers because there's such a wide, vast list of possibilities and areas that you can go into. As technicians, these trucks are as advanced as cars are today, so we need technicians that can work on them and understand how to work a computer system and get them up and running so the customer can make money. These trucks are workhorses, but they're built for comfort and they're easy to drive. Freightliner builds these trucks for drivers' wants and customers' needs.
Welcome back to Prep Huddle Live here on StriveSports.com. We talk with Grand Island Northwest girls coach Rico Burkett now on the Truck Center Company's hotline. Coach, thanks a lot for digging out of the snow today.
Thank you. I appreciate your time.
Last night, you guys begin the Central Conference tournament, and it comes with a loss to Crete. Two of your four losses on the season now have been to the Cards. So what has been a difficult matchup for them and you guys?
I think the big thing is they kind of play that 1-3-1, beyond the 1-3-1, it's just their length. At one point, they have a young lady at the top of that zone that's 6'1", 6'2", and then they have two wings that are 6'1", 6 feet. Just makes it really, really difficult to find open holes or create ball reversal. And I think we were just really tentative, and they had success against us in the holiday tournament. And I felt like that tentativeness kind of carried over, especially in the first half where they were able to jump out on us 12-1 in that ball game. But I credit our girls for battling back to put ourselves in a position where we took the lead with about a minute and a half to go. And unfortunately, down the stretch, they were able to make the plays and we weren't.
What was the spark that the girls found? I had checked in with a few different videos throughout the night and had seen your score and then saw the final. So what was the spark that kind of got them going?
I think a big part of it was honestly the defensive side of it. We in that ball game we turned it over 20 times in the early. Those were the type of turnovers that led to breakout layups on the opposite end where you can't get back to defend. But I thought after that point we really settled in from a defensive standpoint and we started to make the game easy, and which created some opportunities from the offensive end. And I feel like anytime you see the ball go through the hoop, it kind of energizes you in that aspect. And I think that's really what kind of helped fuel our opportunity to get back in the ballgame.
So aside from games with Crete this year, the girls have performed very well. Talk about what you've been most pleased with so far this year.
I think the biggest aspect is our unselfishness and our ability to defend in the quarter court. We've had some nights where we've struggled to shoot the basketball. But I think that's one thing that we try to pride ourselves in is if we do our job on the defensive end, every night we have a chance to win a ball game, no matter who it is. And we've played some really good basketball teams, and in nights when we've struggled to be efficient on the offensive end, our defense has allowed us to stay in a ball game and finish some ball games. So I think that's the identity of who we want to be and we want to establish as a culture of our program.
Your roster is a senior-dominated one. Who are some of the girls that have stepped up so far this year for you?
Kelsey Plocky and Kylie Broick are two seniors for us that return as all-conference players. We really rely on those two young ladies to perform for us. But we've had some nice contributions from another senior, Maddie Ball. She gets our toughest defense assignment, no matter who it is. Sierra Holiday really provides a presence for us in interiorly inside as a defensive force and kind of plugs the paint for us. And then we have some girls that come off the bench, and Taryn Mayfield and Addie Simmons that do a really good job of performing their roles. And one young lady that we're really excited about in our program is a true freshman that starts for us at the point, and Whitney Brown, that from day one has just really come in and taken the leadership role to lead this group of seniors. And she does not play like a freshman. They don't treat her like a freshman, and she wants the ball in difficult situations, and that's a blessing to have as a coach.
With the loss last night, you guys have a few days to kind of regroup. Three straight days of practice doesn't happen all that often, really, during the season before you get a consolation game on Saturday. So what's the message for the girls getting ready for Saturday and then the stretch run of the season?
I think the big thing is obviously losing the way that we did last night, to start off slow, then battle back, take control of the game, and then to have it slip away. We can't have any hangover effect in that regards, that we've got to be able to turn the page and kind of move forward. Crete is a very talented basketball team, even though their record might be around that 500 range. They're a better basketball team than their record indicates. So we've got to be able to move past, and we're going to see a Holdridge who uses some 1-3-1, and I'd probably expect to see that. So we've just got to make sure that we're focused on the task at hand and can't dwell or hang your head on a loss in the way that it happened. You just have to move on, and we always talk about next play, and we've just got to go on to being prepared for Saturday. And we fortunately get the opportunity to play them back-to-back because that's the way our schedule falls. So we're going to have a common opponent. So we've got to make the mental adjustments and be ready to try to tackle their attack.
It's always fun to watch the Vikings on the Strive Channel. And, Coach, thanks a lot for taking some time today. Best of luck to you and the girls the rest of the way.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
Coach, again, joining us on the Truck Center Company's hotline. It's time now for our Strive highlights. We have done this. It's been a package that we've kind of added to the show since we began here in the first part of 2017. And we start our package this week with another David Winget highlight. No, he didn't dunk and land on anybody. No, he didn't shoot a half-court shot. Well, he might have. We don't have video of it. But David did become just the 25th member of the 2,000-point club for Nebraska high school history, and the Winnebago Strive Club was able to bring us that video and the warm reception for David after the shot itself.
Widget up. And there
Bucket's
it is.
Good for Widget
is
and good. 2,000.
And there it is, Winnebago history. Mr. 2,000, David Winget, scores his 2,000th career point. The crowd's on their feet. And they just announced it over the loudspeaker, and the crowd goes crazy. Congratulations to David.
The Emerson team taking showing good sportsmanship.
Hashtag Reds Ball.
Hashtag
2000, 2K. In real life.
In real life. You witnessed it here. And Winget's going to head over to.
He's going to come over to the fans.
I don't have that, folks.
Get that shot.
I'm going to
get down there.
Some.
No, you're good. All right, we're roughing it out here.
Down up front.
I can't see him. There he is. Widget showing some love to the fans, cheering him on here as he scores his 2,000th career point. Gives his dad a hug.
A great honor for David. He's a great kid and obviously a fantastic basketball player, and fun to share the story of David Winget. It's going to be a lot of fun to see where the Indians end up at the end of this year. Next, we can head to Lincoln Christian, where the Lincoln Christian Crusaders were battling with Fillmore Central in a boys matchup this past Saturday.
He was happy with that.
Yeah, they've been a work in progress as far as racing there. Right under the basket.
And Horty, yeah, no. Nope. And there's a Gary Nunley. There's a three on the way by Horty. Misses, but they get the offensive rebound. Shelkoff hits it over to Canfield. He's on the line. That'll just be it. Or no, they were.
Oh, that's a great job by Caleb Burke.
A whole lot. We bring some of these guys in off the bench. It's not, we don't drop off much from our start, but it was a lot of traffic in there. And there's
Boy,
a three on the first lead of the night for the Panthers.
The possessions by Fillmore Central don't last very long.
Here's Shelkoff, drives, takes it all the way. That was a nice move. 10 seconds. All the
there
way across
is.
To or Canfield. He's open,
yeah.
And he's got it. Tushock with it. He's on the floor along with Bigler inside. Bigler puts it on the floor. Whitley tries to go high off the glass.
No.
Shortest kid.
Really what they want to do, I think, is drive and get us to kind of...
Kewin to go right to the basket, bring the lead back to six.
Oh.
And Shrine hits on the line, it's still
there
in,
you go.
Right?
In, yep.
Yeah. And a nice spin move. I swear the other night up at Raymond Central, one ref called about 90% of the fouls.
Got good leaping ability with some nice ups. Jumper for track, there it is.
Fillmore Central, there's another three on the way, and that's...
There now, yeah, that guy bailed.
And Horty is back in the game, and he hits one again. We've got McEwen inside to Bigler, and he scores. Board is a couple of feet in from the end line. If he hits the side, then it's out of bounds.
I don't know how to say his last name here, so I'll just call my own.
Kuzhak is open for three, and he...
We're pretty happy with that, probably. I think that's okay.
Second time tonight when Justin has been way under the basket but is able to come back and score. Crusaders by 29, so they've really taken over in this half.
And some outside play with Caleb hitting the shots, and, you know, I think Gary.
And Horty goes for the steal. And he's got.
Oh, and we got Josh in the air.
And his quarter alone.
Yeah. It's pretty quiet. Right. That would be a travesty. That would be what's wrong with the system. If quarter period.
Taylor wants me to make some comment about Fulmer Central. They've lost two in a row, but the alma mater is playing pretty well overall, and we'll probably see them at some point next week for the Southern Nebraska Conference Tournament. But thanks again to Jake. Jake at Hype Sports also was able to wrangle us up some highlights when Syracuse got real hot against Fort Calhoun.
Good fake from Monty Roberts. Monty Roberts from downtown gets it in to Christian Frederick. They leave him unguarded. Frederick feeling it. Three ball. Got it. Out to Zastera. Zastera attacks the basket. Roberts buries a long three. Both and do both well. Zastera three ball. Zoller turns the corner, kicks it out to Zastera. Gets his man in the air, drives to the hole.
What did the judge say?
Is this our second? Is this our officially
this
our second
the
quarter?
The official second quarter catch.
All right. Cody Ryan, three balls.
Oh!
Here come the Rockets again. Brinkman stops, pops, fires a long three, buries it. Penetrate, kicks it to Brinkman. Brinkman penetrates, gives it inside to Zastera. Coming. Nannon, he finishes. Cody Ryan. Oh, love to make a trip to Lincoln tonight. Zastera, good positioning. Fredericks. Fort Calhoun playing man-to-man defense. Some variety in his game.
One of those games where it seems like the first one goes in and then they all go in. So, big one there for Syracuse. And finally, a Penner poster dunk. We can roll that beautiful bean footage, I guess, right? That's the next one on the list is Henry Penner. He's been in the highlight package before for us here on Prep Huddle Live, and this is from the Instagram account for Dog Pound B-Ball. It's a fun one to follow, and Henry going posterizing on Seward over the past weekend, so... we'll see Henry Penner and the rest of the Aurora Huskies coming up a little bit later on this week. We hope to, anyway. We should be with the Central Nebraska or Central 10 Conference Tournament going on there in Aurora. So our highlights again this week, a big thanks to the schools that contributed, and we love to have more of those. Our of our Strive schools, you got a fun play from a game, or you have a great call from a student on a buzzer beater, anything like that. Let us know. We'd love to feature those highlights right here on Prep Huddle Live. Stay tuned with us on the show. Coming up, we're going to have Tony Chapman and don't forget our Strive TV GoPro giveaway announcement winner. That is next on Prep Huddle Live.
Yeah, I get it. For the little things, technology's great. It makes things easier. It's faster. We can get things done wherever we go. And we get all that from our bank. It works for us. But for the bigger things, the things that really count, I still want to talk to the people I know and trust. That's why I'm here.
Hey, what's going on?
Just checking the fields. Yours are looking pretty good. Must be doing something right.
Actually, I got a guy.
You got a guy.
Well, it's not just any guy. I got a channel seedsman.
Channel, yeah?
Yeah, I've been working with him pretty close to get
what you can see for yourself.
This is what I'd recommend.
Let's get to work.
Now this is what you want to see.
Maybe I should get a guy.
Maybe you should get a channel seedsman.
Find your channel seedsman at channel.com.
Nova Fitness Equipment of Omaha has provided the very best weight room, track and field, and sports surfacing products for over 30 years in Nebraska. They provide Cybex, Matrix Fitness, Vertimax, Tough Stuff, Pro Elite, Stairmaster, York Barbell, Troy Barbell, and UCS track and performance products. From rubber flooring, strength equipment, cardio products, and sports performance accessories, Nova Fitness Equipment has what you need to make your athletic program successful. Contact Nova Fitness Equipment today at their home office in Omaha or online at novafitnessequipment.com.
Home-cooked favorites and online ordering so you can skip the line. That's what you'll find at Dickey's Barbecue in York. Log on to dickeys.com, select the York address, sign in or create a profile, and you'll be ordering delicious barbecue in just seconds. Choose from a variety of meats like brisket, pulled pork, chicken breast, or sausage. Add a home-style side like waffle iron fries, fried onion tanglers, barbecue beans, and even fried okra. You won't go away hungry. Try Dickey's Barbecue today and log on to dickeys.com. Kids eat free on Sundays.
Trucking industry gives you a lot of opportunity for careers because there's such a wide, vast list of possibilities and areas that you can go into. As technicians, these trucks are as advanced as cars are today. So we need technicians that can work on them and understand how to work the computer system and get them up and running so the customer can make money. These trucks are workhorses, but they're built for comfort and they're easy to drive. Freightliner builds these trucks for drivers' wants and customers' needs.
Welcome back here to Prep Huddle Live on StriveSports.com. We have reached almost the end of our show. Don't forget, we've got the GoPro giveaway announcement that we'll get to in just a little bit. Now it's time to bring in our writers, our senior writer, Tony Chapman, on FaceTime. And hello, Tony.
Hello, Eric. Let's do this as fast as we can so you guys can give that GoPro away.
That's what we're going to do. On the sideline this week, we got a fun story you've been working on, and it's I believe it's our first ever feature on One School, Two Sports, if I'm not mistaken.
Well, it's been a while if we haven't done it this way. But, yeah, I had a great conversation yesterday with Amherst coach Bill Giffen at basketball. The Broncos in C2 are ranked third by the Omaha World Herald. They beat Elwood last night 79-40. They got a big one coming up tomorrow. They'll play Sumner Eddyville Miller, who's undefeated in Class D2. They're really looking forward to that one. And so we talk a little bit about the Amherst basketball program, but we're also going to talk about the wrestling program. Eric, a great conversation with their first-year head coach, Chase Klingelhofer, who was a wrestler at Amherst and kind of at the beginning of their run. They've been first or second in Class D every year since 2006. So I think that's above average if you're looking to fill a trophy case. And so this was a really fun story and about how the community really gets behind all of their sports programs. You know, in a day and age where sometimes that small town is dying, a lot of these kids that are playing for Amherst now, their moms and dads played for the Broncos as well in the 80s and in the 70s and 80s and 90s. So really neat story that I hope we'll be able to get up on the website tomorrow.
Yep, it should be a lot of fun. We got some pictures already coming. We got some pictures that Austin took last week when we were – or a couple weeks ago when we were out there for the wrestling invite. You know, something else that is coming up this week, obviously, and we've been slowly preparing for it here in the office. I know you're there in Grand Island, but a lot of fun with the Central 10 tournament and then, of course, the CRC tournament, which there a few games have gotten moved around with the weather, but it looks like we should still be on for a CRC Friday and a Central 10 on Saturday.
Yeah, the CRC tournament looks like they were not affected by the weather last night, so that's good. They've got basically their semifinal set. Correct me if I'm wrong. I tried to pull the brackets here today, but I haven't seen all the scores. So I think on the girls' side, it should just be fantastic. You'll have BDS and Extra Milligan, I think, is the early game. And then the late game tomorrow is Hampton Meridian. So you've got all those teams ranked on the girls' side. And then the boys' side, Eric, is it Cross County BDS and then Nebraska Lutheran Giltner, I think. Is that correct?
That's the way it sounded. I didn't have all those scores, but that's the way the bracket looked to me. Yeah.
I think I think that's right, and we'd be remiss if we probably – I think I saw Steve Merrick from the York News Times post that Nathan Grossniklaus from Shelby Rising City had 68 points in their two games against Osceola and Giltner, obviously out of the tournament now, but that's pretty impressive for the Shelby Rising City star there. And then, yeah, as you kind of discussed, you've kind of had a Central 10 conference feel on the show today. You've got Aurora into the semifinals in the Central 10 conference on the boys side. And then I think the girls are not all the way set yet. I took the family up to Northwest in Crete last night and watched that one, and Northwest led for all of about 15 seconds that whole game. Just Crete does a really nice job. They're so long in the middle, but they play a nice 1-3-1 zone. And I know he talks to Coach Burkett earlier today. So Crete and Seward, I think, is one matchup. And then I think York's going to play Lakeview tonight, and the winner of that one will get Aurora, if I'm not mistaken, in the other girls' semifinal.
Is it Adams Central or is it Lakeview? That York plays. Anyway, that game is tonight.
It's tonight,
and then the winner plays Aurora. That's where we're going. Also, Adams Central does play Lakeview on the boys. I think that's tonight. That's the only score I didn't
there
find on the boys' side too.
That's correct. Adams Central will play Lakeview on the boys' side, and then Lakeview, I believe Lakeview girls are going to play York tonight as well. So Lakeview suspended or postponed both of their games last night. It got a little bit sticky here in Grand Island even, so, and I think the further north you went, travel was pretty difficult.
Yep, so that's kind of what is coming up. And so thoughts, I want to get you, here's your chance before Friday night, Tony, to wax poetically one more time. I know you shared it on Facebook today, the history lesson with the Crossroads Conference Tournament. It's at the York City Auditorium. It's just it's a great classic building. We were in a similar one a couple weeks ago for the Mudecas Tournament in Beatrice, but there is just something special and unique about playing in an old-type auditorium like that, whether it's CRC or Mudecas or whatever it might be, but this one's a lot of fun. Coming up Friday night.
Well, and I think the fun about it too, regardless of where it's at, is that all the games are at one spot, and so that's something you don't see with a lot of these conference tournaments, where they'll go home sites for a while and then they'll get together at one site for maybe the semifinals or even just the finals and the consolation games. And so I think you've got all of the schools are there, you know, your buddies even with some of the people who aren't playing, or they're there watching you. And so just the atmosphere, it's been so good for so long in York, and even as some of the schools consolidate or new teams come in or out of the conference, the atmosphere really stays the same there. And that Crossroads Conference Tournament has always just kind of had a special place. There's a lot of people in York that really helped make that go, and you look at the folks at St. Joseph Church over there who really have kind of helped spearhead that thing for the longest time. So you've got to have other people to make it happen. Even when the basketball is great, you've got to have other people there to help, and they just do a great job of hosting that in York. It's a special event.
And that's the one place I look forward to every year when buying my my program and I get the big quarterback.
Yes, absolutely. The big quarter, the 50-cent piece. You got to get one of those. And you know, if you're a kid, or if you're a parent, you're watching our show, and you've got a kid who's anywhere between, say, second and sixth grade, let them run up in the west balcony there and let them do their thing, because you don't get to watch a game like that when you're at a high school gym in the Crossroads Conference, or really, you know, hardly any gyms anymore, especially Class C on down. That unique view from behind the rim is fun as a kid.
Yeah, it should be a lot of fun. Tony, we look forward to the rest of the week and the fun games that we'll be at. Thanks a lot, man.
All right. Thanks, Eric.
All right, and now it is time for the Strive GoPro giveaway. We have, like we said a few weeks ago, actually just at the start of the year, we had the beginning of the contest, if you will, Strive TV putting together a contest for our Strive schools, where schools had a chance to put together their own school spirit video. It varied greatly on how those videos got presented, but we asked them to share the video on social media, be it Instagram or Twitter or Facebook or however it might be, and we've tallied up the views and the likes and the retweets and the favorites and all of that fun stuff, and we have come up with our grand prize winner. So Taylor Siebert is actually with us right now that can give us, and we're probably live somewhere.
Just Snapchat.
So we're on Snapchat as well. So Snapchat and everyone else, Sandy Creek is your GoPro winner. Huge congratulations to Sandy Creek. Taylor's got the numbers. Views on Facebook, 7,600 views. 12,000 people reached on the Facebook post. Facebook had 110 plus likes, more than 110 likes. They had 208 shares on Facebook. That's ridiculous. Twitter, they posted it on Twitter, got 712 views there. Instagram had 92 views as well. So definitely the big winner was the Sandy Creek Cougars. So this is your GoPro. Like I said, brand new in the box. We haven't even opened it. We thought about borrowing a little piece of it the other day, but we didn't even do that. Very excited. So Sandy Creek gets a GoPro session courtesy of Strive TV. These are the new ones. It's the one button technology. Push it on there, probably download the app on your phone and do all sorts of fun stuff. So Sandy Creek, I cannot wait to see what you guys can create with the session. Very excited about that. And it sat here in the office for a long time, and it didn't go home with Taylor or me or Austin, so we held out very well there. So, Sandy Creek, your big winners there of the holiday giveaway for us on Strive. With that, I believe our show is over. Again, thanks to all of our coaches today who joined us on the Truck Center Company's hotline, to Tony Chapman as well, and we will see you at a gym very soon. We'll be in Aurora tomorrow night for the girls' semifinals, the Central 10 Conference Tournament. We'll be in York at the City Auditorium for the third place in championship games for the Crossroads Conference Tournament there. And then we'll be back to Aurora on Saturday for third place and championship action from the Central 10 Conference Tournament. That's it for Taylor, for Austin. I'm Eric. Thanks for watching us on Prep Huddle Live on strivesports.com. We'll be right back.